So yesterday we had started, or we're continuing with the discussion of the chapter, Making of the Scientist. And what are the things that we read about Eve Wright were his, you can say, his work on the butterfly. So as a childhood hobby, you can say he started studying about it. He had tagged the butterflies to learn about the migration. And to his disappointment, he said that, in fact, he grew so many butterflies in his basement. In various stages, they were there. And he tagged them, but only a couple of them, a few of those butterflies returned. So he's very disappointed with the amount of efforts that he put, and he was all, you know, almost gave up those efforts. Then he participated in a competition in the school, and he did not win a prize. All the other students, he got a prize. He did not get, and later on it was because what he showed, it was not, you can say, it not could be called something scientific. So he had just displayed this frog, you can say, tissue slides. So that is, so displaying something is not science, right? Or just showing something is not science. Then he talked to his mentor, who's that? Dr. Urquhart, the writer of the book, The Travels of the Monarch X, right? And he gave him a long list of projects to work upon. And so he started working upon them. One of the projects that he did was that how, you know, the viceroy butterfly, it copies the monarch butterfly, right? And yes, why? Because the monarch butterfly is not tasty to eat. The birds don't feed on it much. And everybody wants to save their life. So these butterflies may be camouflaging, changing their appearance to look like the monarch butterfly. So he did a lot of work on that, and now he's going to find out what is it, at what stage does this happen, you know, like all the, because when we started this chapter, we talked about that how a young scientist got a chance to present his journal or present his article in a journal which was generally kept for scientists of great repute, right? Experienced scientists. So how these two young men, they got a chance to show their article over there, or to write their article over there. So can we continue with the chapter? Yes, we're going to do this chapter, and then after that we'll come back to our revision part. So we're going to do a detailed revision. I might ask you multiple choice questions every day. You have to read the chapter thoroughly. Okay, so we'll be doing that kind of, I am not going to discuss summaries because it is not going to be a subjective paper. It is going to be a detailed study paper. So let's see various kinds of questions that we can create. Okay, right. So let's look at the screen, all of you. Yes, Nishna is there. Nishna is going to send me the list here, and Justine, send the offline students' names to her, please. Okay, right. Now look at this here, right? The monarch butterfly and the viceroy butterfly. Is there much of a difference here? Because it is not colored. I'll share a colored picture with you all of this butterfly, and then you will be able to find out the differences there and why it wants to copy the monarch butterfly. Okay. Yeah. I can't show you over here now. I can show the ones at home, not you. That is there. So I'll send you the picture in the group. Ibrahim's project was to see whether, in fact, birds would eat monarch. So this is what he wanted to find out, right? Birds, do they eat monarch butterflies? But they found out that they prefer the viceroy butterfly because maybe what reason it was. It would eat, he found that a starling would not eat ordinary bird food. Starling, a kind of bird. Okay, so starling is a bird. Yes, Amitpal? Would not eat ordinary bird food. It would eat all the monarchs it could get. Ibright said later, research by other people, that viceroys probably do copy the monarch. Right, so this, here there was a bird in particular that he talks about that they did feed on the monarch butterfly. This project was placed first in the zoology division and third overall in the county science fair. So see how he's getting prizes for his work, okay? And on his research work. Now in his second year in high school, Richard E. Bright began the research that led to a discovery of an unknown insect hormone. Indirectly, it also led to his new theory on the life of cells. So when you talk about the article that he wrote for the journal, it was about the cell theory, right? So now he's going to work on the hormones. Hormones, at what stage does, the monarch become so different that it is not tasty to the birds? Yes, we're on the top of the page, that first line over there. Yeah. In his second year. Found it? All of you? Mehul, sit straight, please. Butterfly ki study ko entomology kehte hain, is it? Okay. That's insects. Specifically, butterfly study is called entomology. There's another word also. Yeah, so there's another word also. Find that out. Yeah, so he's told me the easy word, isn't it? There's another word also. So find out and let me know, all right? Waiting for your answers. So in his second year in high school, Richard E. Bright began the research. We read this. The question he tried to answer was simple. What is the purpose of the 12 tiny gold spots on a monarch pupa? So pupa is a stage in the growth of the butterfly, right? So before it becomes an adult, yes? So he's wondering that on the pupa, there are these 12 spots. What is the purpose of those spots? Why are they there, right? And how do they help in the growth? So a big question, and he's going to find out. Everyone assumed the spots were just ornamental, decorative. Let's have a nice decorative pupa, right? We'll put spots on it. No, it could not be. But Dr. Urquhart didn't believe it. He said, no, there's much more purpose than just being decorative. To find the answer, E. Bright and another excellent science student first had to build a device that showed that the spots were producing a hormone necessary for the butterfly's full development. So first of all, they had to do one thing, that was that these spots were producing hormones, right? So they first worked on that. They built a device. This project won E. Bright first place in the county fair and entry into the International Science and Engineering Fair. Big discovery it was that these hormones, they do, or you can say, or these spots, they produce hormones. Day he won third prize for zoology. Yeah. He also got a chance to work during the summer at the entomology laboratory of the Walter Reed Army Institute of Research. So very good. Entomology is generally, yes, we have the study of these insects, right? As a high school junior, Richard E. Bright continued his advanced experiments on the monarch pupa. That year, his project won first place at the International Science Fair and gave him another chance to work in the Army laboratory during the summer. So he got a chance to work in the Army laboratory, right? Of course, with all the facilities and everything, because he was working on something quite significant. And just imagine a student here, he's getting this chance. And even when he's in his, you can say, senior school. In his senior year, he went a step further. He grew cells from a monarch's wing in a culture, showed that the cells would develop into a normal butterfly wing scales only if they were fed the hormone from the gold spots. So now he's developed these cells in a culture, right? And if those spots were there, or if the spots hormones which were produced from those spots, if they were given, then the butterfly would grow normally. So he has proved something very, very important, that those spots, they did produce hormones. Okay. That project won first prize for zoology at the International Fair. He spent the summer after graduation doing further work at the Army Laboratory and at the laboratory of the US Department of Agriculture. So he's doing a lot of work and he's getting lots of facilities also. People are encouraging him. And they are cooperating with him in his work. Now, the following summer, after his freshman year at Harvard University, which university? Harvard. We've all heard of Harvard University. Yes, very reputed university, one of there. And so he's got admission into that university. And even when he's there, he's working on that same project, which he started during his school years. Right? Look at the dedication. Ebright went back to the laboratory of the Department of Agriculture and did more work on the hormone from the gold spots using the laboratory's sophisticated instruments. He was able to identify the hormone's chemical structure. So how do you think like a hormone there, like when you do your organic chemistry and you read about all these structures and things like that. And of course, what about the structure? How do you think people are able to find out about the structures? So they do some kinds of reactions there, isn't it, right? And reaction with different kinds of chemicals and the end product also decides, you know, so then they're able to find out, okay, this kind of bond is there, this kind of reaction takes place, and your science teachers will be able to tell you in so much of detail. So you can ask them that, how do they find out about the chemical structure? A year and a half later, during his junior year, Ebright got the idea for his new theory about cell life. It came while he was looking at X-ray photos of the chemical structure of a hormone. So he was looking at the photos of the hormone and he got the idea about his new cell theory about life. When he saw those photos, Ebright didn't shout Eureka or even I've got it. So scientists have shouted, you know, Eureka when they found the answer to their mysteries that they've been solving. Eureka, yeah, I've got it, right? So if you've heard about Archimedes or whether it was other scientists here, so like, yeah, like very happy, excitement. But he believed that along with his findings about insect hormones, the photos gave him the answer to one of biology's puzzles. How the cell can read the blueprint of its DNA. So DNA is very important for our functioning, also for the continuity also, right? So we've read about the nucleus and all. DNA is a substance in the nucleus of a cell that controls heredity, right? So our genes are there. If you're doing about genetic structure, if you're doing about genes and all, you'll realize that how the DNA is very, very important. The nucleus is very important. It determines the form and function of the cell. DNA is the blueprint for life. So our DNA decides what we are going to look like, right? So all the genes there, they decide. So it's already there, you know, the blueprint. What is the blueprint? The design, right? For us, like you have the blueprint for a house. You have a blueprint for a question paper. This is the pattern of it. This is how it is going to be, right? So DNA is the blueprint for life. Ebright and his college roommate, James R. Wong, worked all that night drawing pictures and constructing plastic models of molecules to show how it could happen. Together, they later wrote the paper that explained the theory. So they made a model showing the structure, right? So how do you make these models if you have to make a structure? Like supposing if you have to make a structure of methane or benzene, right? You want to show a model of it. So you put these bonds are there and you use these little balls also to show its kind, replicating a structure, right? A kind of a three-dimensional structure. And then he explained all this theory in his paper. Surprising, no one knew him. Richard Ebright graduated from Harvard with highest honors, second in his class of 1510. Bright student, brilliant student, but nobody knew about his achievements, that he's done something very, very important. Ebright went on to become a graduate student researcher at Harvard Medical School. Then later on, he joined medical school. There he began doing his experiments to test his theory that DNA is the blueprint of life. If the theory proves correct, it will be a big step towards understanding the processes of life. It might also lead to new ideas for preventing some types of cancer and other diseases. So if you're able to identify those kinds of genes which are responsible for those diseases, it would make a big breakthrough in medicine, right? All of this is possible because of Ebright's scientific curiosity. His high school research into the purpose of the spots on a monarch pupa eventually led him to his theory about life. So he started off with a simple hobby. He started with collection, started reading about butterflies. He started tracking them, tagging them. And of course, he had this whole basement full of butterflies, right? Studying about the various stages. Then he wanted to know that why the viceroy wanted to copy the monarch. Then he studied about the pupa, discovered that those spots there, are they ornamental or do they have any function? Yes, they had a function, right? Yes, to release hormones, which were there in the proper growth there. And then, of course, he realized that those hormones, yes, they were like necessary to continue that life or to continue with the monarch butterfly, right? And of course, from one thing led to another, and he was able to come to the cell theory of life. He was able to prove that, see, in the nucleus, there's DNA, and the DNA provides a blueprint for life, right? And of course, if you're able to apply it on humans, you might be able to find out so many problems. You might find the answers to so many mysteries of medical sciences, of life itself, maybe. Right? Now, this was about him as a scientist. There is no doubt that as a scientist, we'll give him full marks. Yes? Ebright was there, very hardworking, perfect, like a scientist should be, very dedicated, very devoted. Did not give up even if there were any kind of, he was never disappointed. He kept on working, right? Now, as a student, what was he like? Richard Ebright has been interested in science since he first began collecting butterflies, but not so deeply that he hasn't time for other interests. So when you think about scientists, do we think of them as boring people who do nothing but research? Yes, see, this is our idea. That's why you don't want to become a scientist. You don't want to be a boring person, that's why. Or you don't want to do something very important. So when you are like, of course, here, which other aspects do you think scientists work on? Not only, you know, medical scientists, what other fields? Yes? Yeah, astronomy. Right? Okay, we have scientists. We need scientists in every sphere. So all these developments, all the advances that are happening, so whether it's about the missiles that we're talking about, whether it's about transport and communication, scientists are working there. Even if a gadget goes from a simpler to a more advanced state, it is because some scientists have worked on making things better. Right? Yes? So what about our scientists there who've been working about, we've heard about Mission Mars, yes? Yes, your MOM, isn't it? Yeah, so what about that? What do we call such scientists? So what do we call such a scientist who's studying, of course, who are they talking about going out into space and going on the moon and all, isn't it? Right? So we have various branches. There are so many branches of the sciences. And this is something very fascinated. And when you watch the movies here and you wonder how the scientists, achievement and that praise that they get for their hard work, that is really something that everybody wants, right? So everyone here, any kind of scientific development that takes place. So whether it is, so if you think about how the trains were before and how the trains are now, the changes in the aeroplanes there, right? From the Wright brothers till now. Nowadays, we're talking about rocket science even. Right? So all those changes here, once again, it's a big salute to our scientists who have made all these things possible. But once again, whenever we think about scientists, we think someone who's put these big specs on and wearing a lab coat and running around with tons of books here and there. Yes. And lots of papers here, writing and rewriting. Isn't it? That's what you think about scientists, right? And we think that, no, this is not the kind of life I want. I can't spend a life of so much of dedication and devotion, isn't it? But Richard E. Bright, he was not like the kind of scientist that you thinking to be. He was a very, like, of course, like any other ordinary student. He had other interests also. Okay, right. So E. Bright also became a champion debater and public speaker. So he was there, he was into public speaking. He was into debating and a good canoeist into rowing, right? So canoe, what kind of a, you can say, vessel is a canoe? It's a very narrow kind of a boat there. Generally one or two people can sit and they go for boating over there. And an all around outdoor person. So is he like your average scientist that you think of? No, he's not. Right, so he's an ordinary human being. He is also an expert photographer, particularly of nature and scientific exhibits. Quite expected, because he must have taken a lot of pictures of the butterflies and all the exhibits that he had to display for his competitions. Right? Yes. So, any doubts here? We stop here. I can see your faces here. I think so. Right. So we'll put an end here.